Good morning, students. In today's lecture, I will start with a new module, that is module 2. Name of the module 2 is Agriculture during post-reform period. And in this first, I will discuss the topic, that is National Agricultural Policy 2000. Agriculture is the base for the development of other sectors of the economy. Its importance lies in the fact that it provides the most essential consumption goods for the people. It is, however, discouraging to note that since independence, agricultural growth on an average was less than 4%. In certain years, the growth rate was even negative. The government played an important role in removing or reducing the constraints faced by the agriculturist. Constraints, that means problems, with the objectives of establishing an appropriate and conducive environment to achieve a higher growth rate of the Government of India, announced a National Agricultural Policy on 28 July 2000. So the Government of India announced a National Agricultural Policy on 28 July 2000. Now, what are the objectives of this National Agricultural Policy 2000? First objective is to achieve a growth rate of more than 4% per annum in agriculture. Second, to introduce the required structural changes. Third, to bring in necessary reforms in agricultural sector. Next one is to make efficient use of resources. Next, to sustain higher growth rate with necessary supporting services like technological, environmental, and economic. Next one, to make agriculture more market oriented. And last objective is to achieve equity, that is all the farmers should benefit from the positive changes in agriculture. The above objectives would be achieved with the help of measures like agricultural research, human resource development, post-harvest management, and marketing. So all these are the objectives of National Agricultural Policy 2000, which was announced on 28 July, year is 2000. These are the features of National Agricultural Policy 2000. So in today's lecture, I will explain features of National Agricultural Policy 2000. First feature is private participation. Private enterprises would be encouraged through contract farming and leasing arrangements, technology transfer, capital inflow, and assured markets for crop production, especially of oil seeds, cotton, and horticulture crops. The areas of private investment and participation have become wider. Big business firms, including multinationals, have entered agriculture and other related activities. Private sector is expected to promote research by investing more to benefit farmers through better seeds and technology. Agriculture will be modernized and commercialized, which in turn will attract more educated youth to this sector. Second one is the competitive approach. Under WTO, agriculture everywhere has become more liberalized with less quantitative restrictions. There is more international competition in this sector. Accordingly, the focus of the government's new policy is on the efficient use of resources and technology, adequate availability of credit to farmers, and their protection from seasonal price fluctuations. Third one is the efficiency in agriculture. In the changed world economic scenario, It is inevitable for farmers to depend less on government support through subsidies and other concessions, but more on efficiency, cost reduction, and competitive spirit, thus treating the age-old agricultural activities more like a business rather than a way of life. Fourth feature is tax reforms. Changes in tax structure or level would be introduced by reviewing the excise duty on materials such as farm machinery and implements, fertilizers, or any other input and activities. The structure of tax on food grains and commercial crops would also be reviewed. Tax concessions would be better than unwarranted subsidies. Widespread subsidies as existing now not only impose heavy financial burden on the taxpayers but also encourage and develop dependentia psychology among the farmers. The new tax law in the form of GST, which was rolled out on 30th June at midnight, is expected to be favorable to farmers. Fifth one is the internal trade. Internal movements and trade in agricultural commodities will be liberalized by progressively reducing the existing restrictions in whichever manner they may be, including tax. This will encourage the market to play its role in the determination of agricultural prices. Government would also enlarge coverage of commodity future markets to minimize the wide fluctuations in commodity prices, as also for hedging their risk. Next one is the plant varieties and seeds. Protection through legislation would be provided to encourage research and breeding new varieties. Government would require to enact appropriate legislation for this purpose. It is necessary to protect poor farmers from exploitation by the multinationals through their patent rights. The other areas that require encouragement for development are animal husbandry, poultry, dairy, and agriculture. Next feature, seventh feature, is infrastructure facilities. Rural electrification, new and renewable resources of energy for irrigation, rural and farm credit are some of the areas of infrastructure where the government will actively involve in providing these services. Increase in productivity of agriculture cannot be achieved unless the required inputs are made available. Energy is the most important input for the progress of any economic activity. Electricity is one of the important forms of energy required for the modernization of agriculture. Next feature is finance. Credit, as we know, is the most important requirement for agricultural progress. The government has promoted a variety of financial institutions to provide credit on easy terms to the farmers. A good number of farmers, especially the small and marginal ones, are yet to be brought within the reach of institutional finance. Efforts will be undertaken to bring this section under the institutional finance through various schemes. Next feature is insurance scheme. An insurance policy scheme to be introduced to cover the activities right from sowing of seeds to post-harvest operations, including market fluctuations in the prices of agricultural produce. Crops insurance provides the hedge against the risk which farmers face due to the crop failure owing to natural calamities. Other areas which have been accorded priority are horticulture crops, livestock species, and aquaculture. Next one is the transform the Indian agriculture. The agricultural policy attempts to transform the agricultural sector from a less productive into a modern, dynamic, and more productive one. A 4% growth has been targeted in order to have enough supply of agricultural commodities. It is necessary to support the agricultural sector with all the required changes in technology, input supply, tax reform, structural and institutional changes. It is necessary to vitalize the agricultural sector so that it can face the competition in the liberalized global economy. India is primarily an agricultural country, which is now undergoing a structural change. In the agricultural sector, there is ample scope not only to increase its productivity and bring it to international level, but also to avail of comparative advantage in the production of many commodities and have a greater share in the world trade. And last feature of this policy is rural development. The general changes in the agricultural sector and in the related activities will help to promote rural development. Development of tiny cottage and small-scale industries in the rural side would reduce the seasonal and disguise unemployment. Indian agriculture possesses numerous challenges and opportunities. The 2000 policy addresses these challenges and attempts to increase the existing opportunities for the educated youth, opportunities for the vast population that depends on this sector. The central government in recent years has made provisions to improve the quality and quantity of all major agricultural inputs. Special attention is given to promote agricultural research and education through the Indian Council of Agricultural Research, that is ICAR. Agricultural Extension Service through Kisan TV was provided on new farming technique, water conservation and organic irrigation, fertilizers and mechanization aspects of agriculture. All these measures, it is hoped that the agricultural sector will achieve the targeted growth of 4%. So all these are the features of National Agricultural Policy 2000. First feature is private participation. Second, competitive approach. Third, efficiency in agriculture. Fourth, tax reforms. Fifth one is internal trade. Sixth, plant varieties and seeds. Seventh, infrastructure facilities. Eighth, finance. Ninth is insurance scheme. 10th, transform the Indian agriculture. And last one is the rural development. So, in next lecture, I will explain what are the implications of new agricultural policy 2000. Till then, stay safe, stay home, and thank you.